When are the guys coming? Hello, everyone. We live in fascinating times. A 130 years old industry is redefining itself and is being redefined. 4 years before now, if you look at 4 years from now analogy, 4 years before now, if you were looking and reading the research of the likes of Forrester, Gartner, IDG, etc., looking at the automotive industry, digital index or digital IQ whatsoever would be far down the list. And you see how things have changed. And I'm absolutely thrilled to welcome here on stage corporate leaders, accelerator, as well as startups to talk about the future of mobility and the coming 4 years. Please welcome on stage. Everyone? Hello? We're getting there? Woo! So before the start, we start the conversation, maybe take the opportunity for everyone to briefly introduce yourselves. Pauline, would you like to start?
Yeah, so hi everyone. I'm Pauline Demonto. I'm the founder and CEO at Drivee. Drivee is the leading European peer-to-peer car rental marketplace, so letting anyone make money out of his or her car by listing it on Drivee. Or if you don't own a car and you rely on public transport and bike, you can find around you hundreds of cars that are parked right there, and you can rent it on Drivee to go on a weekend for shopping at IKEA on a business meeting. So that's what we do. Thank you.
Hi, Scott Lyons, business and partner development for Connected Vehicle and Services. So actually, I've got a great job in being here in startup land. I actually get to spend almost all of my time engaging with startups, trying to find new experiences that we want to bring into the car via our solution, AppLink, and have, really traveled the world looking for the best and the brightest, but interesting to be here today.
Yeah. I'm Anne Knierim. I'm responsible for technology management and research policy at Daimler AG, and we are one founding partner of Startup Autobahn together with University of Stuttgart, Arena 2036, and Plug and Play. And today I'm quite happy to talk about transferring innovation from startups to big companies.
Hi everybody, my name is Ivan Mishain. I'm the CEO and the co-founder of Brightbox. We're doing connected car platform for several OEMs in 40 countries. And that's pretty nice to be here. I think we will have a great discussion.
My name is Martin Hoffman. I'm the group CEO of Volkswagen AG, automotive company. And our beautiful, beautiful daughter, Seat, is located right here in the heart of Barcelona. So we are very proud to be here today.
Good afternoon. My name is Augie Radzik. I'm responsible for connected vehicles and mobility services for Renault-Nissan Alliance. And we're hiring.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, maybe we start with you. We've seen the last 2 days, we've seen exceptional examples of technology transforming kind of every industry from consumer to banking, etc. Where do you see the biggest wave of technology innovation coming in automotive?
Well, I think maybe the most obvious answer to that question is driverless technologies that we were expecting to see, but maybe that's also the most simple answer because you really see in the automotive companies and frankly most industries these days advances in AI and analytics and just capabilities from cloud being brought into the companies. So I see many, many verticals, elements of car companies really aggressively changing themselves and becoming more integrated with the rest of the company. So frankly, I see AI as a big driving force. Driverless is probably how you see it in the real world, and that gets most attention. But you can tell that this fourth industrial revolution is really affecting entire companies.
Martin, how about you?
Well, nothing to add except that there's one more element maybe I want to point out is not the technology itself, but the business model is changing based on technology, and that's completely new. So we are all trying to figure out how to make money on new mobility concepts where others in the market don't make any money. But we as established automotive companies, we are measured by our profitability every quarter, right? So we have to tap into something and be more or less profitable from day one. So technology is changing all of these business models, and we are learning now how to adapt those to our world.
Ivan, please.
Yeah, I think that's like a main topic now, because the industry is actually changing quite a lot, and fully agree the business model will be completely new. And I think that's like the most biggest move for last 100 years for automotive industry, and the business model actually, I think that the big question how to deal with the sharing, autonomous cars, electricity, that's like quite interesting question. And I'm pretty sure like the next 5-10 years we'll know a little bit more how it should work and how it will work.
Yeah, I think not only the business model is changing, we also have to speed up and to bring the cultural spirit into the big companies to change ourselves, to change how we work together. Collaboration will be more important, and I think that will be a big challenge too.
Yes. Oh, loud. Yeah, I mean, well, what do I have to say about this topic? There's simply so much going on in the automotive industry right now. It is a very, very good time to be in the automotive industry, because, you know, what's happening now is that there is a real shift where people that did not even consider working in automotive are now even considering coming into the space, because I think the opportunities that are opening up, the kind of skills and the kind of thinking that's needed is really needed from, in a way, and I don't know, I hate to say this for people that have been in the industry for a very long time, which is a lot of people, we need a different approach, right? Because consumers are changing. I'll give you an example. I myself have never owned a car, but yet I work for Ford. And I had an opportunity to meet Bill Ford one time, and I told him, I've never owned a car. He goes, oh, you're one of those kind of people. And I said, yeah, I'm one of those kind of people that you need to somehow make money from, right? And I think that that's where the change will happen. How to make money from someone that doesn't want to own, but actually does want to consume services.
Thank you. Pauline?
So like an obvious current trend is car as a service. So through platforms like BlaBlaCar, Uber, Drivee. And this car as a service change in the ownership model will be fueled very, very highly by what's coming next, and what of course was mentioned. So autonomous cars are going to make it much faster in growth. So we are in the middle of this game. So it's very interesting to try to forecast the next the evolution of that ecosystem.
Thank you very much. And a question to you. Daimler, everybody knows as a traditional German OEM with a very strong brand. Daimler has made a number of bold moves in the recent past. One of them is actually starting up an Autobahn, starting an accelerator. And the other one, they made this accelerator open to what we would see traditionally a competitor to Porsche. So what's your experience, and how do you see that journey of the traditional industry moving into collaboration, openness, and kind of doing well by doing well with each other as opposed to competing?
I think we don't have another chance than to do it like this. So we want to be successful with Startup Autobahn. We want to attract the best startups over there. We want them to come to Stuttgart, what's probably not the hottest hub in Germany, to be honest. And we think it can only be successful if we put the strengths of the Stuttgart region together, and not to do everybody on their own, but to collaborate, because then we can attract the best startups to come there. They can choose if they want to work with us, or if they want to work with Porsche, or HP, or BASF, ZF, the other partners of Startup Autobahn, and then we will see how it works. And probably it will make us more open for collaboration as well. So to have some pilot projects with Porsche and Daimler, for example, and to be more innovative than we are at the moment.
Stuart, you worked a lot with startups from perspective of Ford.
Yes.
How do you how do you find this collaboration, and how is that journey? How has it been for you?
I'm glad you asked me that question. I agree. I think collaboration within the automotive, well, within across the brands, I think is needed, right? We're obvious competitors on one side, and I think we will continue to be competitors, right? Which I think is a good thing. On the other side, I think we are, I mean, at least from my perspective, the level of cooperation and the level of engagement, at least in terms of, so I'll give you an example. We open sourced some technology a couple years ago called Smart Device Link. We call it App Link, which is basically our linking technology for smartphones that allow apps to go into vehicle. We open source it. You can imagine the conversation that that was internally. So we should just give away the software we spent a lot of money on, give it to anyone else, sure. But we did. And a whole range of OEMs now have, or automakers, have adopted or have joined. And it's really interesting now that on one hand, I'm, you know, speaking to companies and saying, you should join, we want to work with you. And I put a Toyota hat on, saying, Toyota's on board, we're working together. So in a way, we've decided that collaboration, at least in this space, is needed. Simply because, if you can imagine, the number of, I guess, platforms that startups need to, or companies need to support, is very limited. They've got limited resources. How many can you support? I think it obviously happened within the smartphone industry, right? So that's now happening. And it's really, really interesting, because what it opens up is the opportunity for, and another example is Waze, right? SDL consortium just announced that Waze is supporting, and that means that any OEM that takes SDL will now get Waze, at least initially, on iOS. That's pretty interesting in terms of, hey, they're only going to support a few platforms. There you go.
Thank you for that, Scott. Looking at the four major forces that are known to be transforming automotive, Daimler puts it under the umbrella of CASE, and in some shape or form, we kind of, amongst the OEMs, we do share that there's a fact of that connected, autonomous, shared mobility, and electric or alternative platforms will be the ones that will be transforming the industry. Martin, question to you. You see technology, you see the business technology, you see the technology in cars. Which one will be more challenging to manage, and which one will be having a bigger impact? You mentioned changing business models and having to work very differently. So where do you see those two parts of technologies within OEMs?
I could pass this question on to my colleague JJ, our CDO right here. He's not, he's shaking his head because we're having the same discussions every day. I think it's not, we can't predict which one is more difficult. I think the challenge is that we are now facing end consumers with information technology which we have never done before. To a Google and Apple, it's normal that they have consumers. This is what they do. We were never close to our consumers that way, because we have the retail in between the dealerships. So learning how to apply technology in a way that humans love it, to get this notion of a user-driven development, user experience, how you call it, JJ, that's what we are learning right now. We know it from the physical world, how to touch a steering wheel and feel comfortable with it. We know how to build beautiful cars. And now we are learning how to do the same thing with technology. So which one is more difficult to apply? I think that's not the big thing. We are heavily investing in AI, JJ. We're investing in connectivity technology like most other companies as well. But I think the biggest learning experience for us is user experience, what that really means, and how to develop things with a higher user experience. So that's the challenge for us that we are tackling, actually quite successfully, but painfully, but successfully.
Thank you. And Augie, looking at the in-car technology, looking at innovation and your approach of bringing the connected car, which is looking at the OEM development cycles, looking at your perspective has to be a very, very long term, as well as referring to what Martin just said, you need to bring that experience. You know, customer doesn't wait. So how do you bridge that? How do you bring in the innovation from the outside? How do you combine it with the expertise and the complexity that connected cars brings with it in Renault-Nissan?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think this has changed quite a bit over time. Not just for us, but for every car company. Car companies used to source things from suppliers, and the suppliers would bring something in, it would get integrated in the rest of the car, and then it would get shipped and then engineering works on the next generation platform. Clearly with services, everything changes, and now you need to have capability to bring in services during the life cycle of the platform. And that often means that you have to have some core capabilities inside the house. So what we've done in Renault-Nissan, we have actually had a big push on bringing capabilities, software expertise, cloud expertise, analytics capabilities in-house so that we can manage and maintain the software platform inside the car. Having said that, we don't expect that majority of innovation is going to come from our internal team. We expect that majority innovation will come through partners. And what that means is that we have to be able to build the strong, I would almost call them alliances, the partnerships that are so strong that we work with third parties, big companies, tech companies, to bring some of their capabilities in the car. So for example, we announced a big partnership with Microsoft, where we're leveraging Azure and Cortana and some other technologies from them to bring into the vehicles, to make our vehicles more connected and I would say more approachable to people from regular people. So we expect to continue building these types of partnerships with third parties to bring the latest technologies in-house.
Thank you. Looking at connected cars, and yes, I agree with your point with automotive have a DNA of strong relationships with partners, and it does make sense that you say startups or that innovation will be a different partner, and we involve it and include it in our journey. Ivan, you brought to market, Brightbox, brought to market a connected car solution that can be piloted in 1 to 3 weeks. Yeah, so talking about doing things at a, in a different way, at a fraction of time and effort. How did you do that?
Great question. Thank you so much. Yeah, we also sometimes think how we do this. But I think the answer is quite simple. We try to use as maximum repeatable functions, IP rights, what we have. But to have it, we do a lot of exercise together with OEMs, national sales companies, dealerships. That means when we are coming, we at least have 80, 90% what they expect. That means we are able to deliver this right now without any development, without any additional cost. And that's how it works. Because actually, that's, to be honest, quite standard approach for IT companies or for internet companies. That's normally how they work. Then, I don't know, Microsoft or somebody else will come to you. And they will show you at least the most important things what you already need. And that's what we try to bring to our automotive industry, bring the same approach, do it fast with functions what we already have and this right expertise how to implement this in automotive industry.
Okay, and also another thing that you have done is you said it doesn't have to go into the R&D cycle. Yeah, you said connectivity can come in at any stage and can come into a built car.
I think that's quite important because right now the gap between customer expectation, consumer expectation and the OEM possibilities is quite big. And what we are seeing actually with our current customers, what they would like to launch it as fast as possible right now, maybe with some limited services, not what they would like to do, and that's why they would like to take what is already here, what is at least cover the most of their important needs like customer retention services and so on. And after that, to build on top of this some additional services, some additional new revenue stream. That's for sure, and that's normally how we do this.
Thank you very much. So connected cars, autonomous driving is built on connected cars, isn't it? Anna, you had now the second intake, so Startup Autobahn had its first birthday, so congratulations on that. And you had the second intake of startups. Do you see a heat map? Do you see a focus on autonomous driving? Is kind of, it's a bit of a hype around it, isn't it? Where do you see the profile of your startups and the focus on autonomous?
We have not really a focus on a startup, so our applications are all over our our business model. So we see startups for production as well as for sales and after sales. We have some new technologies in. We have startups which are dealing with artificial intelligence, autonomous cars as well, but as well battery drivetrain things. So we are quite happy that we don't see that kind of heat map to some special technology, and that we can see what's most interesting for our departments and who is interested to do some pilots with the startups.
Interesting. So message probably to the startups around here is whichever focus you have chosen for your particular one, if it's applicable to automotive, so we're not just strictly focused on one of the things. Martin, if you were looking at autonomous driving, again, back to the point, as a kind of from a macro perspective, from a macro level, where do you see the biggest challenges? People keep dropping in phrases like technology is long ready. Is it really ready? What do you think?
Also, that is a debate. I'm looking again over there. That's a debate. We can argue if it's going to be 2020, 21, 22, 23. I strongly believe in exponential technologies, which means doubling every second year. So if you think about this, whatever we have today will be doubled in 2 years, quadruple in 4 years. And the question is a different one. I mean, there's so many obstacles to be considered, right? Like you have to train your algorithms in real-time scenarios. So you have to do some mileage. You can simulate quite a lot. You have to learn how to think artificially, what a machine does that does not have the human capabilities of the human brain. So I think we have sensors and the new generations of sensors coming. We have AI algorithms, compute power is increasing dramatically. It's just a question of just getting it done. And the question is how long it's gonna take. I know, JJ, 4 years, 5 years, you pick it. You say three. Years, right? But it's now the plumbing we got to do and learning how to handle this new technology. And many questions that are still open. How does a car react in a situation like this, right? And you cannot simulate every single scenario. And so this, I think, is now the work that has to be done in the next couple of years.
Thank you. So 4 years or 3 years if we go with digital. Polina, autonomous driving will probably be another fuel and take the shared economy to the next level, because the car doesn't have to be driven, you know, by someone somewhere. Where is Drive's business plan in 4 years? Where do you see the biggest push for you will be, and where is your ambition for Drive to be in 4 years from now?
So first, what is good about our model at Drive is that we don't need full autonomous cars to start benefiting from it. So when cars are semi-autonomous, when they are already less dangerous and can, for example, deliver themselves in some situations, it will hugely benefit Drive because trust around the way the car is driven is absolutely key in our business model. So even at the semi-autonomous stage, we are already benefiting from that, which is really nice. And then, of course, the big question is what happens when our business is no longer car rental, but our business becomes robot rentals. Of course, a lot of business models will merge. So maybe BlaBlaCar, Uber, and Drive will be doing the same thing: push a button, get a car for a few minutes to a few days. It doesn't matter anymore. So then maybe there is a differentiation between just getting from A to B as a pure commodity and having an experience during a weekend, because a robot can do much more than just taking you from point A to point B. So we are trying to think about our core competencies, whether it's fleet management, dispatching, or also in-car experience. We are trying to prepare for this rent-a-robot industry. What is sure also is that since the utilization rate of cars is going to go up, it's going to transform the ownership model. So it means instead of only private people buying cars, increasingly you will have entrepreneurs, small fleet owners, larger fleet owners who will control most of the cars. So we are trying to anticipate that in our supply as well. So we are no longer only peer-to-peer, but also open to fleets now.
Excellent. And if you're looking at sharing economy, it's not new. Can we say that it's gone through the kind of the first stage of maturity? Where do you see has the biggest development come to? Which areas do you think were kind of, if you look 4 years back, if you look as it started, where do you see that the model has shifted most?
Well, I think it's all about convenience. I mean, that's our key focus for ride hailing, so more the Uber and Cabify kind of experience. They manage to deliver simplicity in the use case very quickly years ago, and it went very fast from complex to super simple. So that's why they experienced huge growth. On car sharing, it was slower, but that's the main driving force, I believe. It's simplified the experience because it was still too complex. And a very good example of that is Drivey Open, where we put IoT devices inside the cars so that the Drivey app can become the key of the car and you can access those cars self-service. And this is a game changer. We can see in the use cases, it used to be only rentals from 2, 3, 4 days, and now we have shorter rentals booked last minute without any planning ahead. So it's more, we finally managed to replace the need to own a car through simplicity and convenience.
Thank you. Scott, question to you. Looking at the terms of platforms and ecosystems, yeah, some of us are getting tired of listening to those. But we spin off of smart mobility, and with what Ford has built with APIs, etc., you are in essence creating an ecosystem.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, on one hand, obviously, we as Ford want to offer our own services. And we will continue to do that, right? We obviously acquired Chariot, for example, and there's other things that we're doing. On the other side, we will not be in every market offering all of those services. I mean, the world is a very large place. And so what we want to be able to do is actually have tools that startups and fleet customers, mobility customers, whatever you want to call them, can actually use those tools with our vehicles to make them, A, more attractive to either lease or buy. To actually deliver certain types of services. So an example of that is, I mean, we've all probably gotten to a taxi somewhere and the guy has 20 devices on his dashboard, right? I mean, why is that acceptable for a taxi when it's not acceptable for me as a driver, right? Driver distraction seems to go out the window. So what we're working on and actually what we have now and starting to offer this out is actually an ability for mobility, I guess, companies that have fleets to actually take advantage of technology that's already in our vehicles. So you buying the vehicle, it's there, you obviously will work with our tools to enable things like enabling your driver app to interface with the, let's say, touchscreen that's in the car, pushing notifications, taking advantage of vehicle data, diagnostics, all of those things. So in a way, it's kind of offering quite complex solutions, but in a very easy way, right? Because I think a lot of developers and a lot of startups actually want to get on the road quickly, and they want to do it in a cost-effective way. And of course, hey, we want them to buy and lease our vehicles to deliver those services and obviously to continue to roll out. So we're going to have that kind of dual approach, right? Where it's our stuff, but it's also enabling others to do what they want to do with the technology that we make available.
And one aspect that did surprise me, looking at what Ford is doing with smart mobility, you are exceptionally transparent, aren't you? You're posting on your website to kind of read for the whole world. What is it that you are committed to start with? Where you are on your journey? So,
like a progress report, right?
Yes, indeed, yes.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's obviously a lot of heat in this space. Mm-hmm. A lot of people want to know what we're working on because, of course, we get asked a lot of questions about it. Because we're a public company, we want people to understand where we are, what we've committed to, and what most importantly, what we have not committed to. Because generally, it's very easy to deviate from what we've said, right? We're doing this by 2021, we're not doing that by 2022. So we will continue to be as transparent as we can, but trust me, there's quite a few things that we haven't, communicated externally, but there's some interesting stuff coming along the way.
That's behind the scenes, yes. Ogi, Renault-Nissan was having a presentation at CES, where I know there are lots of things that are again going on behind the scenes that probably none of you would be able to talk about. But of what you can share with us, where do you see the major focus of your group over the coming years in getting that simplicity of experience, of making that next step in connectivity, autonomous driving, etc.
Yeah, so for those who were not there, we announced a couple of interesting things at CES, one of which was partnership with Microsoft on connected car and bringing the technology into the vehicle as quickly as we can on an open platform so that we can engage, what Scott was talking about, bringing developers in much easier and have cloud services that we can easily deploy everywhere in the world. What my team is particularly focused on right now is finding opportunities, values in the near term on bringing startup innovative ideas and figuring out how to create, I would say, a platform layer to have an easy path, which historically was very difficult in car industry, to bring startups into the vehicle and actually go into production. Very difficult. It's still very difficult. If you talk to startups, you know, they don't really know who to work with. They'll find some people in research to engage with, but then when it's time to actually commercialize, they realize people in purchasing don't want to talk to them because, you know, they haven't been in business for 10 years and whatnot. So it's really important to be able to bring new technology and new systems into the car. But what I find very interesting, what we're actually working on these days, is how to prepare the company for driverless that's going to come in the long run. So what we've also announced there is that in Japan we're starting a test of driverless vehicles on the road in 2017, and we found that there's a huge interest from people in Japan, from government of Japan, to actually make this happen, and happen sooner than, you know, the big Tokyo Olympics coming, and exciting times for us. So I think if there's one area that really captures the imagination of both my team and other teams in Renault-Nissan, it is the idea of bringing robotized vehicles on the market very, very soon. Much sooner than people think, actually. Now, they will not be able to go anywhere at the beginning. It will be a geofence, certain areas, more controlled environments, I would say. But there's no reason why we can't relatively early start testing point-to-point mobility with driverless cars.
Thank you very much. Electric, alternative energy sources. Do you believe as a group that electric is the future? Or how do you see it? Is there hedging going on with OEMs where there's a hydrogen council, at the same time there's a joint venture to invest into electric infrastructure? There's probably a bigger dynamic going on with European CO2 emissions legislation, etc. Where do you see that heading? What's the future of fuel?
So I'll go first. For us, it's very obvious. We were, I think, the first ones out of the big OEMs to commit to electric. To date, we've shipped more cars than any other OEMs, more electric cars, 420,000 in Renault-Nissan Alliance. Leaf is number one selling electric car globally, and in Europe, it's Renault Zoe. So for us, commitment to electric was done many, many years ago. And if you ask us today whether we believe electric is the way to go, absolutely. When you look at all the, there's still challenges with electric, clearly the charging infrastructure, the range, etc. But those challenges are being slowly overcome. And we certainly view the future as you said at the beginning, some key drivers are electric, connected, autonomous, shared. So we do believe that from electric perspective, we're very well positioned, and huge investment that we did in the past is actually paying off.
Well, the most beautiful sound in automotive is a V8 engine at idle speed. And it can be from a little Italian city in central Italy, as well as anywhere else. Having said that, electric is the future. I think there's no debate about. And being an automotive guy, a car guy, I love the smell of fuel on a racetrack, I love it. But I know the future in urban cities will be completely different electric. Now we can argue about hydrogen power. We are betting, like probably most other companies, not only on one card. So only believing in the battery in the next 3 or 4 years might be not enough. But so hydrogen power is an alternative that is being worked on heavily, actually ready to be deployed when customers want it, when infrastructure is around. Electric will come, but there's right now customers don't want it. If you look at the absorption rate in the market, it's still relatively low based on due to the infrastructure, which is not there, but it's a question of time. And we are ready for that. We are launching 2020, the biggest model fleet in the market by having 12 brands, and they all go electric, to, from Porsche all the way to Audi, Volkswagen, even the luxury brands like Bentley, the Seats, the Skodas, all of them will have electric offerings. So, and customers make the decision by the end of the day, not the people on stage right here. So we'll see how they will adapt electric offerings, but it's going to happen.
Last question. Famous quote of Henry Ford that if he asked people what they wanted, they would want faster horses. I don't know how many of you in the audience also know Dubai have announced a passenger drone initiative, which will go live July this year. Yeah, so we're 6 months away from Dubai flying passengers in drones. A question to you. Do you think we're now at the point of trying to invent a faster car? And how will drones be replacing cars altogether? No?
Oh, God. I don't really want to take...
Did I make you laugh now?
I really don't want to take this one. Gosh, what do I say about that? I mean, I guess you would expect my answer to be, I don't have my crystal ball here today. I'm sorry. I left it in Berlin. However, I think that there probably are going to be some really interesting innovations that are coming out. I was at DLD in Munich in January, and I think it was Airbus or Boeing, I can't remember who, had talked about the fact that they're going to have a flying car by the end of the year, right? Because they don't believe that autonomous and ground-based transportation is viable because there's just simply too many problems, right? Interesting. I'm waiting for the Jetsons to materialize. But again, let's see. I think there probably will be a couple of curveballs that will shock us all, and I look forward to seeing those. Right. But again, it's very difficult. I think to, you know, really think about, well, is our drones really going to be viable? I saw the article, right? I saw the guy standing in front of it and waiting to go in it. I don't know. I think what really is going to come is UPS delivering my package the last mile with a drone. That I see. I'm not sure about widespread adopting of vehicles, because I think based on that same article, it talked about the fact that if you look at the U.S., the FAA has to get involved, right? You start kind of getting into that space, and then it's, I think the regulations are immense. So we'll see. We'll see. I'm not sure if you have a comment about that.
I would love to see drones, personal drones. I would love to see that. But I'm with you. I think the regulations are relatively high. Now, if you read the press today about the drones, the drone encounters, there's a drone dropping every single day and someone on the head, right? And we have a big debate going on worldwide. Spain is banning drones, personal drones, for photography in most of the cities, right? Like Spain is one of the most restricted countries when it comes to flying a drone. And now we want to transport people. I can't see that happen anytime soon. However, technologically, it shouldn't be that difficult at all, right? I mean, at CES, there was a drone presented, a one-person drone, and it made the first test flight in California because it's easier than in Beijing. And so I think it's not a technological issue. It's the dealing with it. And I personally see helicopters flying every day. Why not a drone taking a person to the airport and back? So as a mass transportation mean, probably not.
Okay.
Not much to add other than when you think about how much car companies spend on safety and following regulation, it's hard for me to see that drones shuffling human beings can happen so quickly. I mean, there's a lot that goes into ensuring safety of people that get into our vehicles, regardless of which OEM it is. And I certainly believe that for drones to be able to carry humans like that, a lot more time will have to pass by, a lot more will have to be proven before we can even dream of that scenario.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. Our time is up, and thank you to 4 years from now for being so patient. We've slightly overrun. I hope you enjoyed it. It was a great pleasure to having you here. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.